known art is like the only thing ever. My mother's a painter, and my whole life was just about like being in the studio, so I was exposed all the time. Books, the smell of turpentine, all of this was just my whole life. So I got kind of a head start of understanding that art revolves around everything we eat, the way we read everything. So it was just innate, luckily for me. I didn't, like, art found me already before I even stood a chance. If I would have done anything else, it would have still kind of been related to this to begin with. I think there's a photo of me in my mom's studio still doing that, like, and I still would have access to most everything in the studio anyway, so everything was available, everything, all the opportunity for it was, and then everything became something useful, something to do with. And I guess I remember more making the conscious decision of it as a career rather than something that is life, and seeing it as, I can't imagine spending my time doing anything else because everything else would feel so dull. If that path where you kind of finding yourself and becoming a center of personhood, it was always relevant to imagining making something with a meaning, with a message, rather than just being entertained. So I finally, just when I saw myself in making something, that's when I found an inseparable kind of codependent identity to making work forever. Then I lived in Paris for about 3 years, that's where I did my master's, but I did my master's in philosophy and art history, so it was a purely academic approach, but then of course that, as you explore more of my work, it attached directly. So it was just all in preparation to, I think, really in preparation to where I am now in Berlin. So that was kind of like the ultimate goal, learn to live in Europe, learn different, just expose yourself a bit more, especially when you're in your 20s, to a point where you're like, okay, I've exposed myself quite a bit, now I can just take all of these different cities that I've lived in and exposure that I've had to them, and then really focus on staying in one place. I wasn't planning to move on so much. And then as far as having more international shows, it facilitates the fact that I'm Latin American. When I look at the work that I'm making now and what I felt like when I was in the process, maybe even earlier this year or the years before, it's all in connection to the past. It's all evolutions of subjects that I was once interested in 2-3 years ago, and then it's gotten me to that point. So that research on, like, let's say, for example, things that happen usually in American insurgents in Latin America, or let's say, like, mineral mining in Africa, like all of these things, I was interested at some point for X show. I think this was mostly like the one that was military medicine parallels, Sigma and Jetman in 2014. That one, as much as I explored some subjects, I did a lot of reading that I didn't exhibit or I didn't make work for, and then that leaped me into things that I pick up on now that I remember from like a few years ago. So it is more, I would say, instead of jumping from one thing to the next, all of the work that I've done before still just refers to everything new that I find now. So I'm just constantly connecting to whatever it is that I studied. Recently, I guess even for the last show, it was things that were a lot in writing, things that were very imagined in writing. So for that last show, I do follow things very intuitively sometimes, so I read a lot and everything just kind of goes in one ear and out the other, like it passes me, and then I can find something really concise in like a podcast or an article or any novel that I'm picking up, and I'm like, wait, I don't know why, but this is a good idea, and then I note it, and then I archive all a ton of things, and then what I noticed in the pattern was that they're short sentences, quotes, titles that represent an enormous idea. For this last show, it really was everyday people from the union, in unions, incarceration officers, people that are just, you know, one of so many, but can, in such short words, because they're involved in that crisis, really quote that moment so much better than a writer could, or an observer, or a journalist. Like, they have a way of, people really do have a way, even when it's, they're so kind of disenfranchised from what is informative or intellectual, their opinions sometimes are so hindered. And that really captivated me, was just text done by the people themselves, by people, the people, not just people observing the world, that captures just an enormous amount of things in such a short amount of words. So I guess that has served so much as like the most recent emotional kind of painting, because it's just, it's very emotional at the same time, it's very raw, the source is very real, it becomes somehow even more trustworthy, considering how lack of so much trust has been lost in media, sometimes directly from the source is better. And not over-intellectualizing this, but then it really hones down. And then I guess general, on a larger scale, what if I were to look at all my over, emotionally, I think it's generally more on darker subjects, unfortunately, but I see them as like important observations of things that are so enormous and important, but also so passive. I'm really interested in like the hypocrisy of how we hyper-normalize things in order to make it through life. I feel like that's a response to like capitalism and being functional and productive in the world, but these huge subjects change the lives of millions of people, but they're constantly ignored, or I guess kind of you have to ignore them in order to function in the world. And so that calls my attention to kind of revealing them as much as I can, or commemorating them or making them more permanent in artwork, so that they're not just constantly overlooked. Yeah, I guess as a point of observation, there's an emotionality in that. I knew that this was something that I was on to for a while, I just didn't really know what to call it. And then for my master's program, I had this really wonderful law professor who was doing a minor in theory of law, like the ethos of law. And the way that they had conceptualized the class, because I really liked philosophy law because it's so conceptual, it's really beautiful because it's not practice of it, and it's very poetic. And it goes all the way back to the Torah and the Koran and the text. And within that course, they talked about this very beautifully versed thing called the reveal. So it's like that space between ideologies. So we follow democracy, capital, all of these ideologies. It's like we for some reason they require us to devote ourselves to just one, because if you're not devoted, then you're against it. So there's not a lot of nuance, unfortunately, and it's complicated to have nuance, especially when it's such a short attention span. So what they had called the reveal, I see that so much, especially in like sculpture, conceptual art, and that moment of using an object to reveal something, the hypocrisy of something, just a moment of like looking between or behind the curtain. You see the world as it is for a moment, and then art can just, for a moment, even just for an instant of your whole life, it's beautiful, just an instant, to leave reality for a second and then see reality for what it really is. Removed by an ideological lens, by using ideology, by using images that are referential, then you have a moment of like raw revelation. You can see things for what they are or for what they're never seen as. The hypocrisy is kind of removed for just an instant, and I think that that is a moment of like an encounter, emotional encounter, and intellectual encounter that sometimes art can achieve in the audience of just a moment of truth. And now it's become almost like a new political ideology for the younger generations to not believe in their system, to not believe in everything because of what we've seen foreign policy do. And there's just so much wealth in that, because it's not only something that it really is about American policy, it is the policy in the governments that are around Latin American countries and Southeast Asian countries today. So it's all connected into like what the world is now outside from decisions that were made from the US long, long ago. So if I look into any other kind of, I guess, war crime, it's a lot of them kind of just tie back to original interests that I have with American foreign policy. Like it all just ties back to this. A lot of it just ties back to that. So you can't study modern governments without really delving into American foreign policy. The way that I had researched all of the history kind of created a system for me to look at contemporary issues and look at them in a much quicker way and more confident way to like study them a bit more, because I was able to have the time to look at things that happened. Well, Guantanamo was in recent history, but those shows allowed me to be able to pick out just almost yeah, any contemporary